out, the fate of the Kurds makes them the exemplary victim of today's geopolitical games. Spread along the borderline of four neighboring states, Turkey, Syria, Iraq, Iran, their full autonomy is in nobody's interest. But the true miracle resides somewhere else, in the ability of the Kurds to organize their communal life. This ability was tested in an almost experimental way. The moment you Kurds were given a space to breathe freely, a little bit freely, outside the conflicts of the states around you, you surprised the world. You quickly built a society that one cannot but designate as an actually existing utopia with thriving intellectual community. So you are more than a symbol of resistance. You are a symbol of how not only to resist, but then to install, experiment with, build a new order. This is what is needed today. We get again and again the same boring picture. Remember, in Istanbul, in Athens, in Madrid, blah, blah, you begin big demonstrations, 1 million people cry, shout together, and then the enthusiasm is lost and more or less nothing remains. You remember what happened in Egypt? Almost 1 million people in Cairo on the main square, then you got your freedom, free elections, and you get Muslim Brotherhood. And you are glad that the army makes coup d'etat. What you try to do is, it's not me giving you a historical talk. I am addressing you as one of the few examples in the world how you've demonstrated, proven that, this is my formula, that a new order can be built. People want this new order. Let me give you a simple example. We all watched it probably on the screens. You remember the inauguration of new president Joe Biden. This was, I think, for me, a pretty disgusting ideological event. All happy together, we got rid of Donald Trump, things will return to normality. But then, you know who was the star of the event? A lone old man sitting there, and everybody talked about him. Bernie Sanders, of course. The fact that millions talked about him, I don't want to talk about Sanders, but about the importance of the fact that he attracted all the attentions. Millions downloaded those images and so on, meant that it's not just a couple of us crazy radical leftists, but millions of ordinary people felt that there was something wrong in that big spectacle of inauguration, the old order is back. No, that a new order is needed. Just with his presence there, sitting alone, as if he wanted to say, sorry guys, I'm not part of that show, he gave body to an alternative. People want this, and you, Kurds, you belong to this line. So this brings me to my topic. What's the fate in all of this of democracy? What kind of democratization can help not only Kurds, but all of us? It's certainly not just the expansion of the standard Western multi-party democracy. A tension which is immanent to the very idea of parliamentary democracy is gaining visibility today. Democracy means two things: the power of the people, in the sense that the substantial will of the majority should express itself, and the trust in electoral mechanism. Democracy means, yes, there may be manipulations and so on, but once the votes are counted, all sides accept the result. Of course, we leftists and even some rightists claim this parliamentary mechanism is not neutral. And this is true. This is the crazy thing today. It's no longer that less developed countries, so-called third world countries, are the countries where democracy doesn't function and then we look to the West. No, the standard democracy, multi-party representative democracy, is in crisis in the so-called developed West itself. A step further here. And this is maybe the saddest thing of what is going on today. And I'm sure, from what I've learned, that in your part of the world, things are more civilized. In spite of all the horrible suffering that you have there, we Europeans and Americans are, I'm afraid, the true barbarians today. Namely, the ethical catastrophe of Trump and new right-wing populists is this incredible degradation of public social life. You are able to make dirty jokes, to say obscenities. Decency is disappearing. And here, something very strange is happening today. I hope some of you know a wonderful book by Angela Naegle, an Irish lady, living in the United States, Kill All Normies, where she describes how, I remember when I was young, late 60s, 70s, those in power spoke the official language of dignity, bombastic, patriotic, while we leftist protesters, you know, we made signs like this, used dirty words, we consider this subversive. But did you notice that now, this new so-called alt-right, alternative right, especially in the United States, they use dirty language, sexual obscenities, incredible vulgarity, and so on. And this is a tragedy. The left is, at least the official liberal democratic left, is retreating to old, not only moralism, but even police brutality. Now the left wants to censor public space and so on and so on. It's a total mess, so that then the new right appears more and more as a partisan. That's my first lesson. We have to build a new universalism. You, the Kurds, are my model, not because you are interesting small guys who somehow found your, reasserted your identity. No. You interest me because you are a miracle. Because, not your fault, but because of crazy geopolitical games, you are like salami sliced into, you know, Turkish part, Greek part. This, I mean, customs, manners, how to organize in these crazy times new mode of everyday life. That's the big problem for us in developed countries, maybe even more than with you. You know, we have a health problem with the pandemic. We have economic problem. But I fear, and it's becoming more and more clear, that the biggest problem will be mental health. Violence is exploding because these everyday rituals, customs of people are broken. we are in a terrible situation of literally building new cliches, new customs. We have to construct new everyday life. And here, I'm not bluffing, we will all learn from you. We, Europe and the United States, are ethically a catastrophe. We are lost today. So thank you very much. It was an honor for me.